So thank you for joining this webinar. I am Bernadette Scutella. I am from the team of drying and related modeling technology in the research and development department of GSK Vaccin in Belgium. And today I would like to discuss with you one of the main challenges that we need to face when we develop a freeze-drying cycle and scale-up freeze-drying cycle, meaning the assessment and possibly the prediction of the product heterogeneity. At the end of the presentation, I will leave you my email, so please don't hesitate to write up any question that you have. I will answer to them as soon as possible. So, as I just said, I work in GSK for the vaccine research and development. Freeze-drying and vaccine have a very long relationship. Some of you may know that the first vaccine to be developed was developed by Edward Jenner and was the smallpox vaccine. However, this was still in a liquid form, and it took almost 2 centuries in order to have the first freeze-dried vaccine to be commercialized. However, nowadays, freeze-drying is, I would say, the major drying process to be used in order to dry vaccines and also many pharmaceuticals. When it comes to freeze-drying, we refer to as a secondary operation. So in vaccine production, we have, first of all, the production of the drug substance, so which is the primary operation. Then in the drug product, we receive the drug substance. We add to the drug substance the excipients in order to stabilize it. We fill into doses, so in a single vials. The vials are then freeze-dried and checked, of course, after the process, and finally they are packed and shipped to the market. I really care to introduce the product because, as many of you know, freeze-drying is a process which is very related to the product, is very product dependent. In particular, the product imposes two main constraints to the freeze-drying process in terms of product temperature and moisture content. In the first graph on the left, you can see the evolution of the product temperature during the three main phases of freeze-drying. So we have the freezing, the primary drying, and the secondary drying or desorption. During primary drying, secondary drying, it's important that the product temperature remains below a critical value in order to have nice and elegant cake, so that maintains the same volume and shape of the initial liquid. Instead, if we go above this critical value that can be considered the glass transition temperature or collapse temperature, we will have collapsed cake. We will have collapsed cake that needs to be rejected. So this is a first constraint that we need to take into account. The second constraint is related to the moisture content. The moisture content decreases all over the process. So you can see in the second graph the evolution of this parameter especially during primary drying. So we have a sharply decrease because we have the sublimation of the ice crystal, which are almost 80% of the total water in the product. Then we have the final removal of the moisture content during the desorption of secondary drying until we reach the target moisture content. So the target moisture content depends on the product. For example, for vaccine is no more than 3%, and most of the time we go also much lower than 3%. But we need to assure to maintain this constraint. So product temperature and moisture content impose two main constraints when it comes to the design of the cycle and design on the parameters. Now I would like to introduce another concept with which many of you may be familiar if works in the field of freeze drying, which is the heterogeneity. Generally speaking, we may say that the heterogeneity is the state of being different in some character or in some content, and even heterogeneous population may be divided in subpopulation of different types. So I'm sure that happened to you many times that you did your formulation and filling into the vials, you loaded the vials into the freeze dryer, you run your recipe with the parameters you have selected, and then at the end of the cycle you obtain this. A batch in which you may have elegant cake, but also retracted cake or totally collapsed cake. Why? The problem with freeze drying is the variability of the heat and mass transfer phenomenon that take place during the process. This variability of heat and mass transfer is due to some sources of heterogeneity, which are the variability of the varial geometry. So basically, in a big lot of vials, we cannot pretend that all the vials are identical one to the other. So there will be some variability in the contact area with the shelf or in the bottom curvature, and this may impact the heat transfer. The heat transfer is also impacted by the known edge vial effect. So basically, edge vial will receive a higher heat flow rate compared to central vials. The mass transfer instead will be impacted by the variability or the difference in terms of dry layer morphology that we can have between one vial and the other. And also two other minor sources of variability are the filling volume and the position of the stopper. So in the two images here, they are quite, exaggerated just to give an idea, but these sources can be considered minor as the precision of the filling machine and to the stopper machine is quite appreciable. So with respect to the other three here mentioned, we don't really care about them. The presence of this source of heterogeneity and so the difference heat and mass transfer phenomenon that we can have during the process directly reflect on the product temperature during primary drying, on the moisture content during secondary drying. So in the left, you can see the evolution of the shelf temperature and the product temperature profile during freezing and primary drying. And you can see that the product which was recorded by thermocouples in a Mirlock freeze dryer present different profile. So basically, depending on the position of the vial on the shelf, we can have a different thermal history for the vials. And also different sublimation endpoints, which correspond to the moment at which the temperature reaches the shelf or goes above the shelf temperature. Instead, looking to the right, we can observe a distribution of the moisture content in a lot of vials at the end of secondary drying. So we cannot as well expect that all the vials contained in a lot have the same moisture content. There will be some vials that, so they will space, let's say, in a range of value. In this case, for example, if your target moisture content is 1%, there will be a part of the vials that will have an higher moisture content. So the secondary drying parameters will need to be redesigned. which is the consequence. The consequence of having this heterogeneity freeze drying is that we obtain a non-homogeneous product quality, so a part of the vial may be rejected if the parameters are not well designed, and for the freeze drying scientist as me, the process is quite challenging to be developed and to be scaled up. So which is the solution? The solution that we actually like more is to use mathematical modeling for cycle design and also for cycle scale-up. We can sort between two big families when it comes to mathematical modeling. The statistical modeling consists in feeding hypothesized relationship between different variables with experimental data that usually comes by a design of experiment. So for example, we can create derive the relationship between the chamber pressure, the shelf temperature, and the product temperature by monitoring the product temperature under different conditions and by using thermocouples. But this kind of approach is very experimental expensive, I would say, and it doesn't give you any phenomenological info regarding our process. So we use more the mechanistic approach, which is based on state equation, so equation describing heat and mass transfer during primary and secondary drying. And these equations are just validated, so the data experimentally obtained are used to validate the model and not to create your model itself. Mechanistic model and modeling have three main advantages. So first of all, we save time because running a simulation, once the model is validated, it takes much less than performing a freeze-drying cycle to verify the parameters. We can understand the process, so we acquired information that can be applied also in other situations during freeze-drying development scale-up. And I will say also that modeling is QBD because allow to create, to understand the relationship between the product and the process. So in the next slide, I will present the approach that we use to design a freeze-drying cycle, and I will give you also the reason why this approach is quite limiting, and we will go then into the detail to understand how we assess the heterogeneity of the process. So in order to design a freeze-drying cycle, we perform four main steps. The first step is the characterization of the vaccine formulation, meaning the definition of the critical temperature, so the collapse temperature of the glass transition temperature. Then we we determine experimental data. In case we use the mechanistical approach, the data acquisition will be performed in a DOE by using process analytical tools. Instead, if we use the mechanistic approach, we need to determine the modeling parameters such as KV and RP. Once that we have the experimental data, we can then define our design space, also create or run our model to define the design space. And into the design space, the safe zone of the design space, we define our standard cycle parameters and a proven acceptable range, which is constituted by two worst cases, a low and high one, which present more or less aggressive parameter than the standard cycle. Finally, we experimentally validate our cycle, standard cycle and our PAR, and we do some key characterization after, such as the vision inspection, the moisture content determination, and the potency of the product. Here, I give an example of both the design space for statistical approach and mechanistic approach. We used actually the statistical approach to determine the statistical design space for one of our products. We run a DOA in which of 30 conditions, in which we evaluate the relation of the three operating variables, meaning the freezing rate, the shelf temperature and the chamber pressure during primary drying. And we monitored the product temperature, which is here shown in terms of response surface, and the sublimation rate. So in the left, in the right, you can find respectively the surface response for central bias and for edge bias. So as these are experimental data, we expect to have a certain trend. So for example, when shelf temperature increases, we can see an increase in the product temperature, and the edge bias results to be higher of about 3 degrees compared to central bias. So once that we have obtained the response surface from the analytical, the experimental data of the DOE, we can superimpose the response surface of product temperature and sublimation rate in order to determine the design space. So here is shown the design space for central bias obtained for the same product. The design space is here expressed in terms of sublimation rate against the pressure. The dotted line are the shelf temperatures, and the straight line correspond to the product temperature. So the design space here represents the safe area, because the critical product, the critical temperature of our product was minus 37, which is much higher respect to the minus 39 that we have here. So this can be all considered the safe area of the design space. Here we selected the parameters, the operating variables of our process, the standard process, which is the orange circle here, which were minus 32 and 5 Pascal. And then we selected our proven acceptable range, which is the higher worst case with more aggressive parameter and the lowest case with less aggressive parameters. For the same product, we also have determined the mechanistic design space. So in this case, we had to evaluate the Viali transfer coefficient, but this was based, the Viali transfer coefficient depends only on the vial, so we don't need to do that for every product. And the product resistance, which is instead depending on the matrix, and we need to repeat this experiment every time that we need to determine a cycle for a different product. And from these two data, with by using the model of Professor Pical, we were able to estimate the mechanistic design space, which is expressed in the same terms of the statistical one. So we have sublimation rate, pressure of the chamber, the dotted line at the shelf temperature, and the straight line are the product temperature. So here we can find also the operating variable representing the PAR. The two design space were found to be slightly different, probably due to the uncertitude linked to the experimental value coming from the DOE, as well as the uncertitude in the determination of the product resistance. Now that we have understood which is the methodology to determine and how to use the design space, I would like to spend some words in speaking about the limits of the classical design space. A good practice when we design a freeze-drying cycle is to select the parameter as close as possible to the edge of failure, so to the critical product temperature, in order to maximize the sublimation rate and to reduce the drying time. However, it must be said that when we determine the design space, we determine an average design space. In theory, every vial in our process may have its own design space. Of course, this is not feasible, so we need to somehow find a compromise between the average information that we find in the design space by calculating the design space and the variability which cannot be eliminated from our process. So, what we usually do is to perform, to use some tools in order to integrate the variability of the vial geometry, the edge VLF effect, and the variability of the dry layer morphology into account when we design the scale-up, the cycle. So, I will start speaking about the heat transfer and in particular regarding the importance of the variability of the vial geometry. So, as probably you will already know, the heat transfer between the shelf and the vial in central vial may be expressed in terms of the vial heat transfer coefficient KV. KV is composed by three main contributions. One is the contact conduction, KC, which is given by the contact between the vial and the shelf. And this contribution is proportional to the contact area that we have between the vial and the shelf itself. Then we have the radiation, which is a contribution from both the bottom shelf and the top shelf, and is dependent on the shelf temperature and vial emissivity. And finally, we have the conduction through the gas, which depends on the pressure and the bottom curvature. So is the conduction through the gas interrupted in the bottom curvature in the curvature of the vial bottom. So when it comes to dependence of KV on operating variables and equipment, we have performed action and analysis to evaluate the impact of chamber pressure, shelf temperature, and of the equipment itself. So in the first graph on the left, you can see the evolution of the vial transfer coefficient in function of the pressure for two pilot scale freeze dryers, so LIOA 3000 vials, so we speak about vials of 3 ml, so quite small vials, and LIOB of 6000 vials, and for two kind of shelf temperatures, so we have tested 0 degree and minus 40. So the main conclusion was that the shelf temperature, at least at low chamber pressure, so chamber pressure lower than 10 Pascal, did not have a significant impact on KV. Whereas we can observe that, as also is remarked in literature, that increasing the chamber pressure, our KV significantly increase. So between 4 actually and 50 Pascal, we have a KV of 4 times higher. When it comes to the equipment, we also have observed that at low chamber pressure, so pressure lower than 10 Pascal, which is actually the range of pressure in which we work for vaccine production, we do not observe any significant difference between the two pilot scale freeze dryer. We have actually also determined the KV in different equipment, so not only pilot scale but also commercial scale, as you can see is represented by in the second graph by C1 to C5, and except for the first freeze dryer, we did not observe any difference among the other, which can help when we need to perform the scale up. However, when you perform the experimental determination of KV, you still can have, you can observe some variability in the KV still of central vials. And this variability is much important respect to the error measurement that it can be evaluated. So we decided to investigate the role of the virial geometry on the variability, the impact of the virial geometry on the variability of the virally transfer coefficient. We have performed n-dimensional analysis on a lot of 120 vials, and we have calculated a coefficient of variability of 24% for the shelf vial contact area and 28% for the bottom curvature. These values were then used to reproduce theoretical distribution of KV by considering only the bottom curvature variability, which is the green distribution, only the shelf vial contact area variability, which is the pink distribution, and by considering both variability. What we have observed is that at low chamber pressure, so lower than 30 Pascal, the bottom curvature variability does not impact on the variability of KV. And almost the whole variability of KV for central vial can be expressed in terms of contact area, can be considered as due to the variability of the contact area. So it is very important actually to remark this, because if you work in a range of pressure as we do, lower than 10 Pascal, you actually need to really take care when you choose your vial to the shelf vial contact area variability, and much less to the bottom curvature. And in contrast, if you work at higher pressure, you will need to take into account both. So it can be a guideline when you choose your type of vial and your supplier. The theoretical distribution that we obtained by determining the variability of the vial geometry were also used to estimate the distribution of the product temperature at different operating parameters, so especially at different pressure, 4 Pascal and 6 Pascal. And we have concluded that the geometry can impact on the product temperature variability and so potentially on the product quality for about 2 degrees. So when we select the parameter for our freeze-drying cycle, we need already to take into account that there will be we need to take into account a temperature safety margin of plus minus 1 degree. Let's switch now on the edge vial, and especially so on the edge vial effect. So you can see in the slide the representation of the heat transfer on the vials located on the shelf. So basically, every bar here represents one vial, and higher is the bar, higher will be the heat transfer received by the vial itself. So you can already note that edge vials will present an higher heat transfer compared to central vials. Central vials here is well shown that it has a certain variability in the heat transfer due to the viral geometry variability. But if we focus on edge vial, even within the edge vial group, we can see that the heat transfer is not the same for everyone. But we will have some vials, which are actually the vials in contact with the loading rail, that will present an higher heat transfer than the vials that are not in contact with the rail. So usually, edge vial effect is considered to be due to the radiation from the wall and to the conduction from the rail. And also, it is expressed in terms of KV. This way of expressing the edge effect may be inaccurate, as by definition, KV is calculated is proportional actually to the shelf temperature, the product temperature, and the bottom area of the vial. But the heat transfer received by edge vial is actually received on the wall, so on the sides of the vial, and is due to the radiation of the wall or to other mechanisms taking place into the drain chamber, which are not actually proportional to the temperature of the shelf. So we have developed a 3D mathematical modeling in order to predict the edge effect in different configuration. So for the standard case, we have first developed the geometry of the container. So by the dimensional analysis we have performed before, we were able to reproduce by using the COMSOL multiphysics software the exact dimension of the vial. Successfully, we reproduced a portion of the chamber. So we replicate the vial in order to have five vials, two edge vials, and one real central vial. And then we have added the bottom and the top shelf, the rail, and the wall. Once the geometry was defined, we have also included the three main heat transfer mechanisms to the model, which were the contact conduction with the bottom shelf, the radiation from the shelf, the wall, and the rail, and the conduction through the gas into the drying chamber and to the vial bottle, which is actually often neglected when we consider the edge effect. So by after validating the model, so the model is in steady state and the product that was considering for this case was ice, we were able to understand the different contribution of the heat transfer mechanism on the total heat transfer and so also on the edge rail effect. So in the graph, you can see the heat flow rate for the vial C in contact with the rail, the vial E far from the rail, and the vial M, which is the real central vial. We have evaluated, calculated the heat from the bottom shelf that, as expected, was the same, of course, for all the vials, the gas conduction, and then the radiation from the rail, the top shelf, and the chamber walls. By doing this exercise, we have noticed, we have assessed that the gas conduction is the main responsible when it comes to the edge effect and to the difference in heat transfer between edge vials and also edge vials with central vials. For example, for the vial C, gas conduction impacts for more than 50% on the total of the heat flow rate, whereas we have a smaller, much smaller than expected contribution of radiation from the rail, the shelf, and the chamber walls, which goes between 5 and 10% for all the vials considered. The model that we have developed was actually quite flexible and allowed us to evaluate the edge effect in under different conditions, which revealed to be very useful when we need to perform the scale-up. So we were able to reproduce different vial loading configuration, for example, vials, edge vials partially or totally shielded by the use of a rail, which is our common practice when it comes to pilot scale freeze dryer, because it's easier to load the vials into the equipment. Instead, when it comes to commercial freeze dryer, often auto-loading is used, and so we don't actually need to have the rail, or the rail in any case is not present. So this can help in assessing how heat transfer variability will change between pilot scale configuration and commercial scale configuration, and to assess if our operating variables are actually adapted to be scaled up. Also, we can assess the impact of different thermal characteristics, especially shelf emissivity, wall and rail emissivity. And finally, we can modify the geometry, adapt the geometry to the scale and the freeze dryer that we are using. So by doing different simulation, we arrive to the conclusion that among different features, different factors, we have that the major one that impact the scale-up are the via loading configurations, so on presence or not an height of the rail, the shelf emissivity, and the shelf distance. So it was important to gain this kind of understanding because we can then planify to know this information before we do the scale up to commercial equipment. So we switch now to the mass transfer and in particular to the impact of the dry layer morphology on the mass transfer. So as many of you will know, the mass transfer takes normally from the interface between the frozen layer and the dry layer during sublimation. So the water vapor go through the dry layer and so go through a resistance imposed by the dry layer, which is commonly known as the product resistance. Then the water vapor goes from the vial chamber to the drying chamber. So we have the vapor goes through a stopper resistance, and finally the water vapor from the drying chamber goes to the condenser, and so it will go through a chamber to the condenser pathway. Among these three resistances of due to the mass transfer, we have that the chamber to condenser pathway is usually negligible or important of less than 3%, and the stopper resistance instead impact for about 10%, and it may be often included into the dried product resistance. So in the next we will focus only on the dry product resistance, and the experiments were performed without any stopper. In this work, the product resistance was related to the dry layer thickness by a linear relationship, but depending on the product, we may have also different kind of equations which are extensively reported in literature. And the scope here was to evaluate the variability of the product resistance, which is linked to the dimension of the pore. The dimension of the pore also depends on the value of nucleation temperature, which is actually stochastic among the vial, also if the nucleation is not controlled, so one is spontaneous. So this means that all the vials may have a different nucleation temperature as well as a different product structure. So which was our strategy to measure the product resistance variability? First of all, we have considered a solution to develop this strategy, a 5% sucrose solution, and we have performed the freezing via spontaneous nucleation by adding a nucleation agent SnowMax. Then we have run sublimation tests, which included so freezing and primary drying, by using a shelf temperature of minus 25 and a chamber pressure of 10 Pascal. And finally, we have performed the pressurized test by using the Revo Minrock freeze dryer. So basically the pressurized test consists in a test where we close the valve between the condenser and the chamber. Vials continues to sublime. So at the end we have that the drying chamber is full of vapor, but the pressure still continue to increase. And from the fitting of this curve by a polynomial equation, and by doing the derivative at the time equal to zero, we were able to determine the mass flow rate via the ideal gas law equation. And so from the mass flow rate, we determined the product resistance value in function of our LD. Dry layer thickness. deafness. This experiment was performed at different times during primary dying in order to obtain the complete evolution of product resistance with the dry layer thickness. And it was repeated also 5 times within the same freeze dryer and by using the same freezing method and the same solution, so 5% sucrose solution. The experimental data were fitted by using the linear equation, and it was possible then to determine the coefficients of the fitting, so in this case RP0 and RP1, and the standard deviation of these coefficients in case of controlled nucleation and spontaneous nucleation. From this standard coefficient, and considering the operating variables that we want to explore, we were able to determine the RP distribution. So this case expressed as a cumulative probability. So you can see that the spontaneous nucleation had a product resistance higher than the controlled nucleation, because usually spontaneous nucleation nucleates at much lower product shelf temperature of nucleation, whereas control nucleation in this case was set to nucleate at minus four. From the distribution, by knowing the distribution of the product resistance, and by using the classical equation of freeze drying of Professor Picale, we were able to determine the distribution of the cumulative probability of the product temperature. So this is the variability of the product temperature only linked to the product resistance. And it was found that we were around plus minus 5 degrees, which is actually a lot, but we need also to evidence that these experiments were not performed in a clean room, so the environment was not controlled, and we did not filtered the solution. So this large variability of the product temperature may be due also to this fact. And once that we have the cumulative probability of the product temperature, it's possible to understand, to evaluate, which is the risk of failure for our process. So for example, if we consider consider from the variability of RP, we calculate the cumulative probability of the product temperature for specific operating parameters, and we consider the critical value, the glass transition temperature of our solution, we can calculate from the curve which is the percentage of vial that will have a product temperature higher than the critical value. So for the spontaneous nucleation was 2%, and for the control nucleation was actually 0%. So by using, after determining the parameter via the design space, this can be a check that can be done and that can reassure us regarding the can include, let's say, the assessment of the product resistance and the mass transfer variability. So to conclude, my idea in this webinar was to give you some hints on how to develop a freeze drying cycle, but especially on how to take into account the vial geometry, which we saw that it can lead to a product temperature variability of about 2 degrees. To present to you the model that we have developed for the edge vial effect, which showed that the gas conduction is the main mechanism responsible of this heat transfer variability, and also how to take into account the variability of the mass transfer and of the product resistance. So So I really hope this webinar was useful and interesting for you. Please don't hesitate to note my email and to send to me any question you may have on the presentation. If you want to go further, I also give you here the present the publication that we have regarding this topic. And thank you very much for attending.